It's always interesting when people are said to make a very sharp statement. And here we got one that I think is really useful because it can start a debate. It can start a mental starting point for a very important discussion. It's a Republican, former Republican lawmaker, Republican Paul Kaniorski, who says the following. He says, because corporations have become so international and global in nature, it's highly questionable whether governments can actually control corporations to a sufficient degree to prevent them from controlling governments. So basically the dispute, the conflict he's setting up is that between corporations having a dominant power or governments. That's only, that's of course, in the US it's a done deal. It's a corporate country, it's a corporate state, it's a fascist state. Defined fascism by, I'm not sure who defined that fascism is when the corporations are more powerful than the government, but somebody did. I have to find that reference. But it not only allows you to say, okay, is this true? Is this, if we have this aversivity, this balance between the two, and the corporations are more influential over the lawmakers than the other way around, we know what the role of the corporations is. They make our stuff. They sell us stuff and stuff like that. But what does the government do actually? What is it supposed to do with these laws that it's going to dominate the corporations with? Well, of course, its role is to keep us safe. I listened to Ron Paul now extensively, and he's really for some rules to keep people safe. He doesn't think that everybody should do everything, but he thinks that the ownership rights, if you protect them, then you protect, for instance, my ownership of my health, or my ownership of my backyard garden where I can plant some lettuce and eat it and don't die from let's say mercury poisoning or something like that. So as a result of that that requirement that your property is protected, you get all kinds of laws that will protect it from damage from other people, pollution, and then you can reduce the pollution, can basically fight it. So he does imply a large role for the government to police that, because you have to. It's quite clear. Corporations will kill everybody if they get a chance. They don't mind about pollution. They don't mind anything. It's just the bottom line. It's all externalities. It's not even included in the whole economic framework to think about externalities. There's the whole term externality says stuff that we don't care about, which is ignored effects. But because this guy has said it now, you can wonder, okay, what's the government doing, and how are corporations influencing lawmakers overpowering them in their role, which is to protect us, and you can take the basically, if you are a strict Republican, not a right wing, let's say not the current Republican, because the current Republican is a corporatist. But a strict Republican, then you are somebody that wants there to be just laws in a country. And of course that's not enough, so then you want them to protect the individual, the rights of the individual, which would be the rights to health and a long life and happiness and etc. Then you get a big problem, and I talked about a long time ago, that you have a lot of laws that are created in our system that are detrimental to health. So for instance, there are in the US, I know, laws that mandate, that sort of not mandate but dictate, that people serve certain types of canned food and pre-processed food in schools. By the way, there was recently an article that says that if you eat processed meat, so you have a meat product on your sandwich which is processed, then you have, for every 10 gram or something, you have a 10% increase in cancer. If you don't eat processed meat, you don't have that. And if you have meat, which is basically bacon or something, or ham, or which is not processed, because it's just the, let's say, the part of the pig or that you have been preserving, and now you're eating it, then you don't have those negative effects. So it's something that happens with processed meat that creates carcinogenics, that make it that people that eat that processed meat, which includes hamburgers and all that stuff, to have cancer, and people that don't, not. Of course, this is something that has not been widely announced in the media, And this is something that corporations will very easily ignore, because of course, you know, cigarettes had the same thing. People were saying you get cancer off cigarettes, and no counter propaganda, etc., etc. And that is the battle that is described in who are more powerful, the governments or the corporations. Now, I think it's completely ridiculous to say that you cannot have power over corporations. You have to define which they are. And let's say, because most of us are not fighting in wars at the moment, we are not soldiers, we don't use military gear, you can completely ignore the military-industrial complex, although they are a vehicle to dump nuclear waste in places where the, you know, that are not liked. So what I'm talking about is depleted uranium projectiles. We use like, yeah, I have a nuclear reactor, I have my nuclear waste, you know what I'll do? I'll make a very heavy projectile and I shoot it at the enemy. Then he might not be dead immediately, but his children will have all kinds of birth defects for generations to come, because they basically evaporated that nuclear material in his territory. That's of course another example of corporations not caring about your life, but if there are military industrial complex corporations, then you don't have to be surprised about that. It's very one-sided. Even in the First World War, these tanks were basically death machines. If you you know, if you sit in one, then you're you know, you have a life as some of these tanks and these vehicles. You have an estimated battlefield life expectancy of 4 minutes or something like that. So they're not worried about that at all. They just make the stuff and they sell it, and that's done. That's nice. They are in the factory. That's okay. That's how they deal. But of course, you can have power over the corporations. It's very easy. And it's such a, I think it's such an important thing to realize that you should have power over people that pretend they are doing something, providing something untouchable or fundamental in your life. So Coca-Cola, you know, yeah, we're Coca-Cola. We sell you water with sugar and salt, which for that reason is addictive. It pulls a couple of levers in your body and you want to have it all the time, drink it as much as possible, you feel refreshed. Problem is, of course, that your kidney suffers and your liver suffers and you might develop diabetes. But we are a corporation, we sell this stuff. This is what we do. And we try to do it everywhere where possible. And if we put a sugar replacement in it, then we don't investigate whether you go blind, which is the case with the stuff that they put in. As a result, because, you know, we're rich enough in order to make sure that the government is steps out of the way. Well, the person that can be in the way, that is of course you. And I guess everybody should be in the way of corporations that can be shown to skirt the laws or have influenced them. And it's very tricky, because recently I wrote a piece about it. The EPA changed laws of radioactivity, which basically increased the acceptable level of iodine-133, which is, you have iodine-129 and iodine-133. And if you have the Fukushima reactor, these two types are different, because one has a half-life of 8 weeks and the other has a half-life of 10,000 years. So the one is, and the type of particles that come out of it are different. The one with the half-life of 8 weeks is measured, but not so dangerous, and because of course it's the half-life is 8 weeks, so you know, you wait a couple of years and then it's gone, or it's basically very hard to measure, it halves itself. But the one with the half-life of 10,000 years is much more abundant, it's much more prevalent in the iodine isotope emissions of a nuclear reactor, but it's not measured. And what they did with the EPA is simply increase the level of that. They did another one, which is because they want to have nuclear batteries. Yeah, I believe it's strontium, which is an isotope that emits electrons, I believe. So they basically caught some type of photon. What they do is they put this radioactive material against a solar cell, something like a solar cell or an actual solar cell. And those photons that come out of it will create electricity in the solar cell. And then you make a very nice tiny package of that, and you have a battery that lasts for 30 years. But of course, after 30 years, that material will be wasted in the air environment, or it will be crushed, it will be put in the waste bin, everybody has to discard it, and it ends up everywhere. So then the background level of strontium will go up, and in order to be sure that it's not a problem. You change the laws as a corporation, you already change the laws so that there's no alarms going to ring when the background radiation in your country is increasing. Another example we have in Holland, where we have fracking. It's banned at the moment, which is very good, and it's really made quite an issue. What preceded the whole fracking initiation, there's a British country that want to frack in Holland. It's like, we're going to be the gas hub of Europe. I'm not for fossil fuels, but that's the case. We're going to be a huge gas exchange in Holland. It's already a huge gas exchange, because all the gas come from Germany and enters our country, is upgraded, and then it's sold around, apparently it's sold around Europe. So we have enough gas from Russia and our own wells still a little bit. So we don't need to go fracking here. So it's completely ridiculous. But what they did was way before, for some mysterious reason, they changed the law for water quality to one that was more local. They recently did the same thing for GM crops in Europe, because we don't like GM crops. We know that they're bad. We know they're useless. So we try to keep them out, and we set a criterion: if you can prove they are safe, then you can use them. And that's impossible. It's not possible to prove they are safe. It hasn't happened, at least. So what the GM lobby did was lobby, of course, because they have plenty of money, and try to make sure that now, from now on, the individual states determine whether they accept GM crops, and then you can start corrupt local politicians. And if you succeed doing that, let's say in France, for instance, then they say national government is, and then you corrupt a little more, and then you go local government, until you find some asshole somewhere that is poor enough to accept enough money from you to accept his GM crops. And then you can say, well, they're using it there, why don't they use it everywhere? It's ridiculous. That's the strategy. So you try to find a weak link, and if the whole of Europe is too strong, then you break it down. That's also happening with water quality. Basically, So the law proposed, in order to make the way easy for fracking in the future, and of course weaken any procedures against water quality loss due to fracking, was simply to lobby for somebody to propose that the water quality standards were going to be local. And that was met with suspicion already. I think we got a pretty alert bunch of politicians in The Hague. Even the Jaeger, and on the other hand, of course, we're completely pro-banking and all this, that we're completely invested in the whole fiat currency idea. But in that respect, you know, that's simply the whole, I think that the origin is in Europe, that we fought a couple of wars. We recognize, so I think I don't have much time left, but the difference between the US and Europe is that the industrialization happened, that made people redundant. So we basically had the same process going as the US has going, corporatization and stuff like that. But then we had a couple of wars which were opportune, because there was all these different countries. In the US you don't have that. You can start a war between the US and Canada, but let's say that was not really possible. But in Europe it was, so this war erupted, either because people wanted it to and egged it on, or spontaneously. And we learned about each other's use in these wars. And we basically, after each war, we basically grew more respectful of let's say, the addition to society, even in an industrialized society. So after the Second World War, of course, in the UK, in England, emancipation and the power of women was very important, because they were the only ones that were making everything and making sure that stuff was still there. And so that's where our social, and of course then we had a fresh start, and we could make social laws, just like the founding fathers in the US had a constitution they could make as a new start. And that was wiser. But unconsciously, we basically fixed the problem of industrialization by being more social, mandatorily more social, which is what you need to do if you have machines making anything ever. That's coming back to robo economics again. We have a little bit of it already. But this video is way too long. Thanks for listening, and I hope you enjoyed it.